Very happy to be working with them for the first time, but hopefully it's not the last. I want to specifically recognize three individuals who were the driving force in all the planning efforts. So please stand up. I know you don't want to, but I think you have to. Dr. Christina Layton. Dr. Marcia Otto. And Jay Rozelle. So Jay will be speaking later, but he's also our intermediary slide transmitter because the remote is not working all the way. So he has double duty tonight. I also want to acknowledge several other groups that partner with the museum and Crossroads on this event. The University of St. Thomas, Fort Bend Archaeological Society, Houston Archaeological Society, the Archaeological Institute of America, Houston Society, and the Friends of Archaeology, aka Father Bader's group, who we still remember fondly. I'm now going to pass the mic to Christina Layton, who is going to provide an overview of Crossroads Cultural Center and provide an overview of the format for this evening's program.
For those of you that have come to some of our events, we know you know we go on Italian time anyway, so sorry for the delay. Thank you. For those of you who are attending a Crossroads event for the first time, we want to tell you a few words about our charism, our mission. Crossroads is a nonprofit organization that was born in New York over 13 years ago by a group of friends who share a passion for cultural work and the desire to create a place where people from different backgrounds can meet and explore together different aspects of the world around us. It is now in several cities across the US, and tonight's event marks the last event of our eighth season here in Houston. A little about our mission. We are not interested in promoting any prepackaged ideology. Rather, we have the somewhat ambitious plan of making a fresh start, where a fresh start is not a matter of a new idea. It is instead a matter of a renewed curiosity, an interest in what surrounds us, yielding to that mysterious thirst for knowledge and meaning that marks us. If we had to summarize our mission statement, it might be test everything, retain what is good, people, events, our heritage. This focus on reality as an event rather than on ideas really determines the style of our cultural work. We believe that the reaffirmation of the positive value of reality, and especially of the human person, is crucial to any attempt to do educative and cultural work at this point in time. If you'd like to know more information about us, what we do, or how you can contribute, please stop by our registration table, sign in, and information is also on our program. So without further ado, tonight's format, Dr. Stewart, I'll introduce in just a couple minutes. We'll provide the opening remarks on the relevance of Urkesh, one of the oldest cities in history, to modern archaeology. Dr. Stewart will also introduce our guest speakers, Drs. Giorgio and Marilyn Buccellati. Their presentation will be followed by a question and answer session from you. And to conclude our evening, Mr. Jay Russell, Vice President from Fort Bend Archaeological Society, will make some closing remarks. Dr. Stewart is an associate professor of art history at the University of St. Thomas. He teaches many courses, including sacred art, Byzantine, medieval, and his area of research include archaeology of the Near East, such as Cyprus, Lebanon, Egypt, Israel, and Turkey. So please let me welcome Dr. Stewart.
Good evening. My job tonight is to set the tone of the evening, to provoke some thought, and to provide a context for us to welcome our guest speakers, Professors Giorgio and Marilyn Buccellati. I'm an archaeologist who investigates the development of architectural technology in the Eastern Mediterranean. And in the year 2011, I had planned to conduct an archaeological survey in Syria. Now, at that time, I was studying the development of castles on the island of Cyprus. Let's see if this is working. There we go. On the island of Cyprus and southern Turkey. Historically, these lands belonged to the Byzantine Empire, and impressive, innovative castles were being designed there about 100 years before the First Crusade. For example, notice here how this castle is camouflaged by the mountain itself. In fact, the castle is part of the natural environment. So my job as an archaeologist is to understand the relationship between the natural environments and human technology that manipulates that environment. And thereby reconstructing the original form. Can you go back? Back. So that castle I just showed you in Cyprus seems to be related to this castle in Syria. So that's why I was planning to travel to Syria, so I could compare these two types of churches, one in Cyprus and one in Syria. However, in the spring of 2011, I was told by the U.S. government not to travel to Syria because protests were taking place in little villages across the land. And in that summer, the first clashes occurred between the revolutionaries and their government. It is important to note that the wealthiest and largest cities remained loyal to their president, Bashar Assad. Eventually, rallies became riots, and eventually, uncivil words became civil war. The castles I had planned to visit, like this masterpiece at Crac de Chevalier, with its, with its Gothic design that has remained intact after 18 centuries, it too became a casualty of war. Next slide. So you could see here, the loss of ancient Syrian archaeological sites pale in comparison to the loss of human life and the destruction of contemporary Syrian society. To most Americans, Syria is a place out of sight and out of mind and has little effect on their lives. Of course, to the contrary, we live in a global world and we are all interdependent. All the ancient sites of Syria, so here I show you a map that lists some of the ancient sites. All these ancient sites have left an indelible mark on our world history, and these will always serve as a reference point to our future histories. Next slide. So Dr. Buccellati will be sharing with us his work located at Urkesh. Could you advance it? Here in the north, notice Urkesh is located on the northern border of Syria between Syria and Turkey. It's not too far away from the famous site of Göbekli Tepe. I think this is important because it's we now are beginning to see that Göbekli Tepe was one of the first centers for organized religion, and it seems that Urkesh may have been one of the first cities in this region. Next slide. So the Syrian civil war makes this research very difficult, to say the least. Today, the Syrian government controls these areas here in red. Next slide. The so-called free rebels control these areas in yellow. Next slide. And then in the northern area, this is controlled by the Rojava, which are the Kurdish tribes who have created a government that is actually pretty stable today. And then here you can see in black where this organization known as ISIS has set up its headquarters in the city of Al-Raqqa. Its strangely shaped domain indicates how it's taken over the rivers and desert highways all over Syria, as well as the oil fields along those roads. Next slide. So effectively, ISIS controls this whole region, almost half of Syria. Next slide. Now, the city of Palmyra was once a gem representing the spread of Roman civilization. Actually, previous slide. Yeah. Here we go. So, the city of Palmyra was once a gem representing the spread of Roman civilization in Mesopotamia. In the year 260, it broke away, forming a short-lived Palmyrene Empire. Next slide. But for whatever reason, ISIS decided to blow up this monument and its on-site museums. Currently, the site is under control of the Assad government, but most of the territories around Palmyra is still in ISIS hands, and we haven't even begun to assess the damage that has taken place here. Next slide. So while many professional organizations like the Archaeological Institute of America and the American Schools of Oriental Research has condemned ISIS and destruction of arts, most academicians, especially my colleagues in arts history, they seem to have remained silent. There are many reasons for this. Let me just share with you one example why I think this is occurring. Throughout the 20th century, artists have been known to destroy their own artworks. The next slide. For example, in 1960, the well-known Swiss artist Jean Tinguely built a self-destroying machine. Next slide. This machine self-detonated to critical acclaim. And then, because it didn't completely blow up, Tinguely took an axe to it. And what he wanted to communicate is that sometimes destruction is an act of creation. Next slide. Here in Houston, we got plenty of examples of Tinguely's work. Located at the Minot Collection. And in a sense, we could say these kinds of theories that destruction is like creation are now considered mainstream. Next slide. In 2004, a group of artists were evicted from a studio complex in New York City. One notable sculptor here, Mr. Rekovitz, protested by demolishing his own sculpture. And the art community praised him for his protest in this fashion. Next slide. The glee that critics have regarding the destruction of art, and I believe is symptomatic of our nihilistic culture. In fact, in the year 2009, next slide, a BBC radio host seemed to justify destroying art for the sake of art itself, so destroying art for art's sake. Now, as both an art historian and an archaeologist, I want to go against the grain here and say, actually, destruction is not the same as creation. Okay, next slide. For an artist to destroy their own work is one thing. For terrorists today, to destroy the art of antiquity is altogether a different matter. Let me explain. Next slide. Most Americans and my students, sometimes they see archaeology as something distant, somewhere over there, in the middle of nowhere, irrelevant to their modern lives. Now that's one perspective. Next slide. Here's another perspective. The truth is that modern Egypt depends on ancient Egypt. 15% of the Egyptian economy depends on tourism. Modern America also depends on modern Egypt. If you have a favorite cotton t-shirt or a bath towel, it was probably made with cotton grown in Egypt, not to mention the Egyptian petroleum production that affects Houston's refineries. Next slide. My point is that ancient Egypt is part of our global society, and economic problems in the Middle East affect prices here in Texas. Next slide. Between 1999 and 2000, archaeologists and art historians under UNESCO began preservation of the well-known Bamiyan Buddhas to help encourage tourism and in this impoverished area. The size and scale of these, next slide. The size and scale of these sculptures were not just images of religious history, but represented a flowering of East-West cultural exchange in the early Middle Ages. And as such, they are important for all of world history. Next slide. Unfortunately, new Taliban leadership in 2001 thought otherwise. They proceeded to drill holes in these sculptures and insert dynamite in the statue. What stood for 15 centuries was erased in 15 seconds. Next slide. this is all that remains today. I remember news commentators at the time describing the Taliban officials as medieval barbarians. To the contrary, the Taliban and ISIS in Syria are actually totally modern organizations. They use cell phones, they use computers, and they use contemporary weapons. Modern technology that complements their modern ideology, one that seeks future global domination. Next slide. So having worked in the Middle East for 20 years, this type of cultural war is all too common. Sectarian violence is more violent today simply because modern technology is more sophisticated and precise. Next slide. Besides the looters and illegal excavation, monuments are disappearing faster than professors and students can study them. That is why most Americans could not understand and still can't understand why these passive office buildings were the prime target of terrorists. Next slide. It's because they symbolize something. They symbolize American world trade. And these buildings symbolize our values of free trade and free market capitalism. These are the ideas that the terrorists were attacking. Next slide. It is the same ideology that is trying to rewrite Middle Eastern history, not only destabilizing governments, but also executing archaeologists themselves. Archaeologists, scholars, students, humanitarian workers, and of course, they're attacking ancient monuments, and it's their way to rewrite history. Now, next slide. Now, everything I've said so far seems gloomy and bleak. However, as a professor, I believe in professing truth, that no one can truly rewrite history simply because in archaeology, historical reality tends to emerge, often revealing forgeries, exposing secrets, and documenting falsehoods. In fact, the doctors Buccellati have a wonderful message for us tonight, that we scholars, we students, and all of you, members of various archaeological societies, you all support archaeology, and even the humblest Syrian villager can fight back. We can all do it in our own little ways. So we are very privileged to have the Buccellatis here in Houston. They have made significant contributions to archaeology. Now let me just say a few things about what they have done. Next slide. 10 years ago, next slide. When I was a doctoral student, I began studying the late Roman archaeology of the upper Euphrates River, studying how ancient Christianity spread between cities like Dura Europus, Zenobia, Edessa, Nisibis, and Mosul, and this region known as the, next slide, the Turabdin, that area at the top. As I was studying these areas, at that time I kept on coming across publications of earlier material, materials I couldn't resist reading. Next slide. These publications covered these important sites known that were excavated by the Buccellatis, Turka and Urkesh. Though these sites are not as famous today as Babylon or Ur, we believe that the site of Urkesh might rewrite our understanding of the rise of human civilization. Next slide. So these are some of the publications. I've counted 26. I stopped counting at 26. They have many publications out there that are quite impressive. Next slide. So we give credit to the Sumerians for inventing the first writing system. However, there was a contemporary civilization that arose in the Indus Valley. Next slide. So the Sumerians here. Next slide. The Indus Valley here in India. And of course, the rise of civilization in the Nile. Next slide. Next slide. There you go. Some scholars actually believe that an even older civilization, the Elamite Empire, might be even earlier. But it's the Buccellatis who's been working in Urkesh that they conclusively argued that this was the capital of the Hurrians, and the, which is one of the northernmost cities in the Fertile Crescent. Now, most archaeologists at the time believed Urkesh was a mythological place described in stories until the Buccellatis were able to conclusively prove that their site was the capital of the Hurrian Empire. Now, that alone would have been a great contribution to our understanding of the of Mesopotamia. We could list it alongside all the other greatest archaeological discoveries, but there's actually more to the story. So for the past 10 years, rumors have spread around the archaeological community that Urkesh might actually have been built earlier than the year 2100. It might have been built 1,000 years earlier, meaning it's one of the oldest settlements in northern Syria, and it's and the fact that it's close to the site of Göbekli Tepe, just 130 miles away, see, might indicate that maybe the first cities might have arose in the northern part of northern Syria or southern Turkey. So the question is this, is there a relationship between the earliest religious complex and the earliest city? Only future research will be able to answer to this question. All right, so let me introduce our speakers. Professor Giorgio Buccellati has two PhDs, one from the University of Chicago and one from the Catholic University of Milan. He's, like I said, he's the author of over 25 publications. He has won prestigious awards from the Archaeological Institute of America, as well as the UCLA Faculty Research. He is currently professor of archaeology at the University of California, Los Angeles. He's also the founding director of the of UCLA's Institute of Archaeology. It consists of 10 departments and 6 schools. It has 17 archaeological laboratories. And in 1999, it was renamed the Kotzen Institute. Today, it's the largest and best endowed institute for the study of archaeology in the world. And I also want to introduce Professor Marilyn Kelly-Buccellati. She is a professor at California State University in Los Angeles. And together, they both have spent their lifetimes helping us understand what it is to be human and how to understand the growth of human civilization. So please help me in welcoming them to Houston.
Thank you very much, Charles, and all of you for coming. After Charles' introduction, I want to add a few words supplement, in a way, what he has been saying. I was just thinking to myself, reflecting on his observations. We are really in a state of disarray, it seems to me, as archaeologists, partly because of the destruction, and partly because of what we have not, as a class, as a discipline, done, what we have not done before the destruction, to try to not avoid it altogether, at least mitigate it. And to some extent, our talk is to show you our little effort that, for reasons that were really totally unknown to us in a way, we were never anticipating that we would have this trial by fire that the war has caused. So in a kind of common sense way, we have come up with. We often say, Marilyn and I, that we were never taught to do what we are doing, neither do we teach today, anybody really teaches today to do what we have been doing. We're just trying to cope with huge problems on the cultural and the human level. What Charles was saying about the so-called Islamic State, I don't like to glorify it by calling it ISIS, it's really the so-called ISIS. What is characteristic and terrible, really, about them is the determination, the ideological and programmatic determination with which they're doing. It's not just casual vandalism. It's not even hatred that comes out and that manifests itself in a moment of rage. It is really a programmatic and calculated attack on the other. if you think about it, there are two Western experiences that are similar: colonialism and totalitarianism. They both deny, in different ways, colonialism not as harshly as totalitarianism, but they do deny the value of the other. And they want to assert only themselves as the core of the world. It's another form also of imperialism. So what we have learned, and to some extent our talk is going to become progressively more personal, because in a way we are sharing with you a human experience as archaeologists and teachers that we have been living in these recent years, especially since 2011 when the war started. So that is really, in a way, we are proposing our, turns out that our project is a sort of model against the so-called Islamic State, against all fundamentalism. What is it that can be done to, even before, upstream of the destruction fury, to set the basis so that this does not happen again? In a way, what Christina was saying at the beginning about Crossroads also ties in with this. Sharing without a closed mind each other's views, the genuineness of human experience. And in our case, you see, we were always looking backward. We were bent down to the ground, excavating, and tried to make the best of human experience of 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. But it turns out we also had to make the best of human experience of today, because the community, the local community, has emerged as a bulwark against destruction, and our work with them is what has, to a large extent, made it possible. So we are really finding roots in us that are very different from anything that we have ever seen before. So I would like to begin with the next slide to remind us of the darkness of the moment. So we'll use throughout the talk occasionally some dark background to remind us of precisely of the destruction for destruction's sake, this programmatic destruction. The next one takes us to Palmyra. It's the image you've seen before. And the next one reminds you of Khaled al-Assad, a good friend of ours who was brutally murdered, and he was very much in the news, so you probably have even heard of him. But one personal reason for having this, the next one, reminds us of the temple of Baal in the center of the city. And on the upper right, the next one, a modern structure that's actually a recent house that was in use by the Department of Antiquities for archaeologists. And it has a special meaning for us because we spent there our second honeymoon in 1966 in August, and it was even hotter than Houston, you tell me, is in the summer, except it was very dry. We spent a month doing a survey in the steppe all around Palmyra, so we really know well precisely the landscape that we see in the news all the time today. And we live in that little house, which the next one shows as having been destroyed. And the next one, or rather, it is the next one has, should have a circle around the house. The next one, that is not, the house itself is not destroyed, but that's behind the, beside the point. Well, what I want to go through with you briefly and in silence are the names of the images for most of them of 11 functionaries of the Director General of Antiquities and Museums who have been killed in the line of duty for different reasons. So I'll just read their names and we'll go in silence through them and the dot shows you where they are on the map. As you see, they are scattered throughout Syria. Khaled Abdel Razak al-Isa. The next one. Yahya Ibrahim. The next one. We can just go through them. Yahya Abdel Fattah al-Mufda. Huda al-Hammoud. Abdullah al-Mayad al-Khalaf. Mohammed Ahmed al-Mahmoud. Abdullah al-Hamid. Qasim Abdullah Yahya, who was killed in Damascus. Khalid al-Assad, he is the one we saw before. And Ismail Muhammad Ali. And with him we close. The next one shows a close-up because it's the most moving of these pictures. These are all pictures from the Director General. So they're official pictures. And the fact that he looks at us with his children is very moving. Now these are all members, there are about 2,500 functionaries of the Department of Antiquities. And these are the 11 who were killed in the line of duty. I will be speaking, in fact, exclusively about the areas that are under the control of the government and so of the Department of Antiquities. In the areas controlled by the rebels, there have been occasionally in some areas that are under the control of the opposition, that have, where also work has been done to protect the antiquities. But to a large extent, the majority of the work has been really been done by the Director General of Antiquities, which is the one I will concentrate on. And we can begin, the next one, with three sites, Damascus first, and then Palmyra and Marula. Now, the one of Damascus is really just an image taken a few months ago in December. We went to Damascus for the first time in 5 years for a small congress, archaeological congress, which was really very subdued. It was very much archaeological. There was nothing particularly showy about it at all. But the one thing that impressed us the most, and this image will be paralleled by the very last image that I will show you, also about young people. These are young students from our area, from the area of the Northeast that Charles showed you, who were there. They're all women in this case. The one at the end will show you some young men, but certainly women are in the majority because most of the men are in the army or have been killed. What impressed us very much was the vigor of these young people, and that's the best sign of hope. The title that Charles had, Reason for Hope, is really essentially here. They're determined to rebuild their Syria. They come from very different backgrounds, including these who come from the same area, but they're really from different ethnic and religious backgrounds. And they are all determined really to remain in Syria, for one thing, to the end, as it were, and to rebuild it. So there is a great sense of hope. The next one takes us to Palmyra. And what I'll show you are pictures by one of the colleagues, a Polish colleague, who was in Damascus when we were there and gave this talk on Palmyra. The Poles had been very active in Palmyra itself, and they had, among other things, set up the museum, of which you see here a hallway, as it was in 2014. They had kind of remodeled the building and especially restored many of the, and that's how this gallery looked in April 2016, when they, the Poles, with the Syrians, together they were working, went back to restore, to the extent that was possible, the damage done. And I'll show you the damage, but it's in function of what has been done. So there is hope even here. They had taken all of the small objects from all the museums in Syria to Damascus, but some of the bigger ones they couldn't take. And so that's what happened. And this is where they are beginning to put them together. This is another one with the mosaic. So here you see they're beginning to actually sort through the pieces and catalog them, organize them, and then eventually put them in crates so that they could take them back to Damascus. And one of these particularly significant one is this very large statue, which was outdoors because it was to be the lion of Allat. Allat is a goddess of the Palmyrenian pantheon, and it had been restored in, that's how it was in 2005. And they covered it when the war came because they couldn't move it as it was. So they covered to protect it. But when the so-called Islamic State took Palmyra, they did, of course, remove the cover and willfully destroy it. So they went back, and in 2016, so in May, a little less than, well, almost a year ago, and they had 5 months, I mean, they did it quickly, but after 5 months, Palmyra was retaken. It was retaken in the December when we were in Damascus, and it was a very tragic moment when the news came during the talk that I'm showing you now. The Polish colleague was showing this, and the news came that the city had been retaken by the so-called Islamic State. So, but this shows the so what had been done in May of last year. So here they are taking the thing and bringing it back to Damascus. But when we were in Damascus, what also impressed us very much was this exhibit, which is set up. This was either their own pictures taken in December, a museum that was for modern art, that is for modern art, but they had used two large halls for objects that had been taken either from Palmyra itself or at the border when they were trying to take them out. And if you think of how the context that you all can imagine for Damascus, this too is impressive. The effort that is made on the you know, level of the government, of the administration, to still have room for culture, and in a very meaningful way. The very fact that it was in a modern art museum, I find to be very significant. Here we are talking to the colleague Bartosz, the Polish colleague. Manula is another story. It's a city very near Damascus, and it's well known not only because of its architecture, but because the people there speak Aramaic in a version of the language which is very close to the ancient one, which was spoken in the time of Christ, and so by Christ himself. And it's well known because of that. It's also it's a very large and strong Christian community. Here you look at it from the side, and here you look at it from the top. It was taken for a few months by a group of the faction of the rebels that was very destructive, as you can see. And I'll show you somewhat in sequence, we can go fairly fast, of the images taken when it was retaken in 2014. It was just for a few months under the fury of these. This is not the so-called Islamic State. It's another. It was another faction. And you see, they really went again very systematically against everything, objects. And this is also very typical of a pattern of destruction: shooting at images, religious images. You see the bullet holes on the fresco. This is very common. Or decapitating statues, for instance, the statues of the Virgin in particular. So they went back in 2014, and what is impressive again about this is obviously not the detail, but the systematicity with which they went back at it. And I also like to say that practically, even though the city is Christian, the archaeologists who were working there were really practically all Muslim. It's something of which the Syrians were, and to some extent still are, almost ashamed of saying. That is, to they find it improper, as it were, to identify their religious background. And I say it really only because it's a tribute to the very openness of the of these colleagues. So they went very systematically about it, and again, we can go quickly through some of these, which show you the determination with which they got to work immediately to restore the buildings. And also a school for the teaching of Aramaic. This is also significant. Look, at the top it says in Arabic what it says on the lower level, the Aramaic Language Institute. And below, it's repeated in Aramaic and in Aramaic characters. This is about half an hour from Damascus. The lower level instead is the Red Crescent. And inside, there are classes of Aramaic that are, were immediately reinstituted. So this too is a sign of hope. You see, the attachment to their past in a very passionate way. And this image is also very moving. The affirmation of the religious identity in a very public way, which is even more stunning in this picture, which was also done in, I think this was over in 2016, sort of after they had done the restoration work. It's very significant because at the top there is very large statue of Mary, who is called in Arabic below Our Lady of Peace. And below, almost as a graffito, a cross, and in Arabic it says, the light of the world. It's very impressive. And to finish my part, I want to say a few words about the Director General of Antiquities and Museums. They have been doing an extraordinary work, really, of protection against, you see, the, you have to think it's not only a matter of the work itself that has to be done, but you can imagine local people have also their own priorities and say, but when there is a war, why are you worrying about antiquities? They are the first ones who have to face and say, no, there is value in culture. Not that people don't share it, but you can well understand that in a moment of panic, of tragedy, they could feel discouraged. And they also feel discouraged because they feel abandoned by the Western colleagues. That was an undercurrent theme in our meeting in Damascus, how glad they were that we were there and that we showed them support. So the next one shows one aspect. They continue to publish. These are books that come out last year, in 2016, about the past. This one on the left, for instance, is an index to the, I forget how many, about 30 volumes of a journal that they have published. So the determination to be very serious also. It's not just a populist kind of approach to culture. And then they set up large posters. This was dates back actually to 2012-13. These are large posters that were set up in all these major cities of Syria. And when I say large, I mean large. See, there were 40 of these posters, all of which say something like it's our cultural past, it's we identify with our past and so on. And one more to show you the thing. So with this, I will now let the podium to Marilyn, who will show you, as I told you, we are becoming more and more narrower and personal, because now Marilyn is going to talk to you about our little project, a big project. And I will then come back for some conclusions.
So, the next one.
I'd like to show you what we have been doing at our own excavations in Urkesh, ancient Urkesh Tomozan. First of all, as a constructive model, we're trying to present a picture of hope. And as Giorgio said, it's hope during a time when we had no idea that this was actually going to happen. And so it's another way of doing archaeology, which also, as I said, we never took any class on. Nobody ever said anything to us about it when we were in graduate school. And the broader implications of this effort that we have made and combating also the sense of impotence. So I'll go through briefly just some of the things that we have found. Professor Stewart showed you these maps, so you know that we're in the northeastern corner of Syria, the next one. And one of the things that we found was this great mound in the center of our site, which has this monumental staircase. It's from about, well, it used to be from about 2200 BC, but we found that it was even older, only recently in 2010. And so part of the underneath staircase, a staircase that you don't see, probably dates even to the fourth millennium. The next slide. And we also excavated a palace from about 2200 BC. And we know quite a bit about the inhabitants of this palace, which is also nice. The next one. We excavated an underground shaft, a structure that that goes down. It's 8 meters deep and about 5 meters wide, and it is for calling up the spirits of the netherworld. And we have a lot of Hurrian texts about this kind of ritual. And we know in Mesopotamia they never had this ritual because it's very dangerous calling up these spirits. We also found traces of important, some important sculpture. This is a plaque, a stone plaque, which shows you a picture. It's the oldest representation that we have of Gilgamesh and his friend Enkidu. The next one. The site is large. The team was always large, and we are able to find even the smallest little pieces of mud which had seal impressions rolled on them. Difficult. We asked our dentist, do you have any old dental tools? Because we could excavate these very difficult pieces of mud with broken dental tools. And so we have a great thanks to our dentist over the years. And so you see how little these pieces are of mud actually were, and how careful, because they're not baked or anything, so they're very fragile. The next one. But it was worth it because we found seal impressions from a king of Urkesh. His name was Tupkish, and you see from the inscription on the side. The next one. Also, the royal family. So this is Tupkish sitting on the right, his wife Ugnitum sitting on the left, and two children. The next one. This is the scene, two seals of the Ugnitum, the queen. The next one. This I particularly like because it shows the son who's standing on the head of a lion. And children really love this lion. Let's go to the next one. So a detail of the lion, he has his open mouth. And we went to a grammar school, the next one, to show this material. And the next one, this is another. And so we asked the children to send us some of their thoughts about the presentation that we made. And this is one of them that you can see there. And this student was, Michael, was very impressed with lion. They could pick anything they wanted. And the next one. is the abbey, this underground shaft, and the visitor was impressed with the underground shaft. So a description and a little picture. The next one. This is a great one because it shows Ognitum sitting there, and the student was impressed by, you know, the fact that she was holding her hand up with something. And then that's the cuneiform inscription mentioning Ognitum there on the lower right. And the last one is also, there's one more of these students. This is two students. And what they were interested in. And one of these students even describes what she was wearing on that day so that we would remember her. It's very, very charming. But pretty accurate, too. I think we have to all be impressed. One of the values that we want to talk to you about tonight is that we always had respect for the dignity of the finds, which means that you have to have respect for the dignity of the finds while you're excavating it, and then you have to conserve it afterwards. And so the next group of slides will show you our conservation efforts. And the reason the conservation efforts are so incredible in our area is because the climate is a continental climate, so it rains a lot. The next slide. It snows in the winter. The next slide. It is very fertile because of that, so the environment is very important. This is the wheat that is, and maybe the next one. Yes, this rain and this hot sun in the summer have varied serious effects on the archaeological monuments. And so here you see this great amount of water next to this monumental stone staircase. The next slide. And also in the winter, it's difficult on the mud bricks of the walls. For instance, here you see the walls of the palace. The next slide. So from the beginning, we sought to conserve the mud brick walls, and we have a system of trellises, which is non-invasive, that sits on top of the, not on top of the walls, but on top of the area around the walls. And next slide. The trellises were covered with canvas. They were covered with various materials over the years. The next slide. So this gives you, the system was simple, and that's important. The next slide. And it was covered with canvas, and canvas is simple to work with and also easily available. The next slide. And one of the things is we didn't want the primary evidence. We didn't want the walls to be hidden. And so, yes, we wanted to protect them, but we didn't want them to be hidden. So we, after many renditions, we had curtains made out of this canvas. And so these are the curtains closed, and the next slide show you the curtains open. So the primary evidence, the ancient document, is there available. The next slide. This just shows some details, various problems, the way we solve them. Sometimes the canvases were colored. I mean, this is, you know, from the early 90s we're talking about. So we had a lot of experience over the years to cover these walls. So is this, if you have two documents in one, the colored walls showed various parts of the palace, and then we still preserved the ancient walls that you see here. The next slide. I think you have to push one more. Yes. So as Giorgio mentioned, we didn't know that the war was coming. I had no idea. So what did we do? The next slide. As I said, these values of the dignity of the archaeological finds were very important to us. The next slide. Simplicity, I just mentioned, was very important to us. Local resources, this is our salvation, the simplicity and local resources. We didn't have some, you know, monument covers that were designed and completed in Europe and brought there. The next slide. And maintenance, it was extremely important to maintain these covers over the years. So the next slide. So values, we instilled in our workmen, local assistants, the fact of the importance of the archaeological materials, and they have they took that to heart and have continued it in the 6 years of war, and now we'll see how it's working. The next slide. And so these are the team, as it were, of people who have been helping us to conserve the site during these 6 years. The next slide. Sometimes it is just very, very simple methods. Now, when we would go there and material was available, we didn't do this, but now we have patches. Patches are very easy to make, and just with a needle. And so, yes, in this slide you can see some of the patches. So maybe they're not very elegant, but they do the job. The next slide. But sometimes the canvases are so broken that they have to repair them. And so they're not the same color, but again, they're simple and they work. The next slide. These are several parts that have been repaired. The next slide. This is, sorry, this is what the site, what the palace looked like in April of 2016. So the war started in March of 2011, and 5 years later, the walls are still in good shape, and the covers of the walls are in good shape. The next slide. This is the underground structure, this necromantic pit, for which there's no comparative evidence for this from any other site, so it's unique. And this is when we found it in 2004. And the next slide shows you, in 2013, we had put a dome over it to preserve it. And in 2013, the canvas of the dome was totally destroyed. And we decided to send a message. We're always talking about values here. We decided to send a message to the local people. We are in this for the long run. And we said, don't cover it with canvas. If you can find metal to cover it with, we would prefer metal. And that's exactly, next slide, yeah, that's exactly what they did. They covered it with metal, as you see here. And fortunately, the next slide, fortunately, also because, as I said, soon after we covered with metal, there was a big snowstorm, and it was fortunately protected. Next slide. Urkesh Open City. So what's happening in Urkesh is something different from the war. We are lucky that, the next slide, we are lucky that ISIS is 60 kilometers away from us, so 60 kilometers is not all that far. But in our area, it has, I mean, and yes, it's always the war, there are always car bombs, there are always some shootings, but relative to the destruction that you saw from the Professor Stewart and Giorgio, relatively it is calm. Next slide. That map was taken, was from the New York Times in October 2015, and this is October 2015 on our site. The people are conserving the site, because it rains so much, it's very important, these junctures between the stones, that they are kept intact. The next slide. So here they are working, men, and the next slide will show you some women who are working to conserve the site. The next slide. We get reports. So yes, they are working and they're doing it the way we taught them to do and the way we figured it out together. But we are still part of it. It's not just them working on their own, because if they have, they give us reports. We have over 10,000 pictures from the beginning of the war of these conservation efforts. And these are the kind of, the next slide, kind of images that we get. So they had a problem and they wanted to fix it with mud, and so the next slide, they fixed it with mud, and this is the slide showing how they did it. Again, the covers for the mud brick walls. The next slide. We also get reports from them, and it's in Google Translate, and so it's very, they're sometimes very funny. But this young man couldn't go and bring the material to Kamishli, which is the site near us, so that they could be sent to us, because it had snowed too much. The next slide. And then they have timesheets, which they sent to us every month. And so he didn't go to work for a week because he got married. I marry my wedding. This is Google. Okay, the next slide. There were also four exhibits that I just want to briefly talk to you about. The one of them was in 2010 at the next slide at the American Embassy in Damascus, because they had asked us to make a next slide, an exhibit for the 4th of July. You know, 4th of July is always very important in embassies. And so, yes, and so this is the next slide. This is the exhibit. This is the exhibit also in the National Museum. It went afterwards to the National Museum in Damascus. The next slide shows you the website of the ambassador and in Damascus, and the next slide shows you the opening in the museum with the Syrian Minister of Culture and the Deputy Chief of Mission in Damascus. The next slide, and the two flags together. This is probably the last time for a very long time that you'll see these two flags together. The next slide. Also the meeting in Rimini, a big cultural festival in Rimini in 2014. We had an exhibit on our work in Syria. The next slide. And we invited three members of the Department of Antiquity to come to talk. And the man on the right, the last one, is from our area, from Kamishli. And the next slide, he said afterwards, so again, Kamishli and very close to the so-called Islamic State, he said, why don't we have that exhibit or an approximation of that exhibit in Kamishli? And so the next slide, he organized an exhibit, and it was, and we helped him, but he organized this exhibit in Kamishli, and here you see that people going to these, and we see how nicely they're dressed, and the next slide shows you that they brought their children also to this exhibit. And then it moved, so that was in January, December 2014, and then February 2015, it moved to various small towns around there. So, and this is in the little city that's closest to our excavation. Again, the exhibit attended by lots and lots of people. The next slide. Well, this is black because now you see something that's not positive. The next slide. This is the famous slide of all of those Toyota trucks that were moving from Mosul up into Syria. And the next slide shows you how they were actually taking our panels from a small city to small city in this pickup, in this, and happy to do it. And so we're very proud of the difference in values that were are exhibited here. And then, of course, the destruction that you saw before. And then the next slide, the students, the young people who are putting up the exhibit in one of these small towns where the exhibit went in 2015. The next slide. Then our colleague from Kamishli, we suggested that we could help him to make an exhibit recently. So you know that the New Year is Nowruz is in Los Angeles. It's a big holiday too. The 23rd of March. And so for this 23rd of March 2017, he made another exhibit. We helped him, but he made another exhibit about a Kurdish excavation in our area. The next slide. And you'll just see the various panels. The next slide. And the large number of people, young people, who are so happy to be part of this exhibit. And the next slide. Yeah, various people. The next slide. Visitors who came to the next slide, to the exhibit, the next slide. Yes. Okay, so one of the things that is important to us was that we would share what we were doing and the importance of what we were doing to our local people. And so the next slide shows you us giving, we would give lectures at the end of the week, during the work time, at the end of the week, to the workmen. So these are two lectures. I'm always trying to talk to them about ceramics because, you know, we find over 40,000 pieces of ceramics every season. So it was always important to try and motivate them to find them all. And at the end of the season, they would be very well dressed and they would come and get an overview, and the local officials would come to get an overview. And this is one of our guards with his daughter, who he brought to see the excavations. And the next slide shows you another man who brought his little sister to see what was going on the excavations. The next slide. They were always very, very curious and had wonderful questions, really. And we were involved with the local community from the beginning. In the 80s and 90s, there were two things. First of all, the school, there was a one-room school in this village on the site, and the roof was leaking, it was partly falling down. So we built them a two-room school. Okay, so it was a mud brick building and it only had two rooms, but it was better than they had. And about 10 years ago, the government built them a three, the village is very small, a three-room school of cement, of course, a much better school. Then there was the problem of the cemeteries because they were burying the people on the site. So we negotiated with them if they would stop burying their people on the site, we would excavate a very peripheral area of the site where we didn't think there was anything. We excavated there, we didn't find anything. And we said, we would like to bury our human bones that have already been studied, we're finished with. We would like to bury the ancient bones in the cemetery too. And they said yes, and that has worked wonderfully for us. This is a man who owned a field on the site, and he wanted to dig a well. So we said, okay, we will excavate there first. We found an administrative building from the third millennium. So we said to him, we're sorry, Salah Abrash, you can't dig a well there. He was really kind and generous. He was a poor man, kind and generous about accepting that. And so we dedicated the publication of that building, actually, to him. The next slide shows you another season. We've been excavating the site since 1984, so we have lots of experience with what's called nowadays community archaeology. It was just, as Giorgio said, it was logical to us. It was the human thing to do. So there had been almost no rainfall in the winter, which meant that they had no crops. So there was really devastation in the area. So we had 1,000 people come and ask us for work. And what we said was, well, we don't have money, but Giorgio wrote to every friend we have in Los Angeles and asked for money, and people sent us money. And so we were able to, we didn't hire 1,000 workmen, we were able to hire a lot of work, well, 500 workmen. But we didn't have the staff also to follow the excavation. So Giorgio had this idea. There was one area, a big plaza right next to the monumental stone staircase that you saw, where we knew there wasn't anything. And so we decided to excavate a trench, a big trench in that area by hand, and with a supervision, with a supervised by only one or two people, because we didn't think we would find anything. So we were able to maximize the manpower through this method. The next one. They're all just experiences. We hired handicapped people, and that was unheard of when we started hiring handicapped people. But for us, you know, we're all Americans. We know that the handicapped people can do so many really important and valuable things. Okay, this is a man who came to us walking on a stick, and so we bought him a pair of crutches, and he worked out wonderfully, and was for years washed the ceramics from the excavations, and in the end he got a full-time job with the local water department because he knew how to work and he was so independent too. The next slide shows you his brother. His brother came crawling. He couldn't walk upright. He came crawling from his village to ask us for a job. We said, sure. So we bought him a crutches, but he had to learn how to live with human dignity, to walk on 2 feet, not 4 feet. Not for appendages. So gradually, and in the beginning, he would get a ride. Somebody would give him a ride to come to work. But he was able to sit there and to wash shirts. And his eyes also do not focus, so he couldn't really advance too far. But he was happy to wash shirts for us. And in the end, this is 2009, 2010, I don't exactly remember. He walked from his village with his crutches upright and was so proud of the fact that he now was like every other human being. Okay, the next slide. Another young man, he is a deaf mute, and he was working on the excavations, but it was kind of dangerous for him to work on the excavations. So we said, no, you work in the kitchen. The kitchen. The cook was a Christian from nearby village, and so he took him under his wings. And this guy was so funny and so lively, and he had all kinds of hand signals for all of us. The next slide. He worked out brilliantly in the kitchen, and he now works in a restaurant in Damascus. So we're very proud of that. We also tried to educate the local visitors, any visitors, but especially local visitors, with very simple panels, with information sheets that were printed on our printer in our excavation house. The next slide. And we had these little like music stands near important parts of the excavation. So if you were really interested, you could read this little music, the information on these music stands. Otherwise, you could just walk by. It wasn't necessary. The next slide. Also, educating local children. These are children from the local school who came to get a special tour of the site. And the next slide shows you the visit, again, the visit of the local children. We had visitors from the United States, and the next slide you'll probably recognize. That's Marta Cheen, who came to visit us once. And the next slide shows him talking to our son, Federico. The next slide. Lots of people, tourist groups or other excavations came to visit us. And the next slide. These are people from the Met. The man on the left is the director of the museum in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. So we had, as I said, lots of visitors. The next slide. We now, in December 2016, we published a guidebook. Before we had those panels, but now we decided to publish a guidebook. And the panels were in English and in Arabic. And now we published a guidebook in, the next slide, English, Arabic, and Kurdish. And this is it, the first time in Syria that such a guidebook has ever been published. And we're proud of the fact that we were able to publish it in Damascus. And now they have it at the site and they can give it to the local people and also to any visitors who come. The next slide. Yes, these are some more pages of the guidebook. The next slide. The power of women. Okay, we had proposed to establish a eco-archaeological park. 54 square kilometers, 22 villages. And we had started. The next slide. Showed you the park and the area around the site. So it wasn't just the site, it was the villages around the site, the 22 villages. And it started, the work started, and these are two rooms that the government had set up for workshops for producing crafts. And so these, the next slide shows you, and it was called the Gate of Urkesh. The next slide. They set up in one of these rooms, we didn't suggest it or help, a little museum of photographs for themselves. In the other room, the next slide, they were making crafts. Women were making crafts. Women are and continue to be so enthusiastic about this. The next slide. And they make these. They made these dolls. So charming, these dolls. Oh, next slide. There's two more dolls, and the next slide shows you that they made themselves. Even the next slide, even a logo. That's a detail of the logo that they made for themselves, and the cell phone, where to call them. The next slide. Now, the women, some of them got married and had children. Others moved away, and so in October 2016, we said, "Well, why don't you have a course for younger women now who would like to learn how to make these local crafts?" So they did, and we said, "Send us a picture of the course." And so they did, but they didn't want the photographer to come. He's a man, and they didn't want him to come. So they said, take it with your cell phone. Okay, they took this with their cell phone. And notice, there are no faces because they took it from above and you just see the hands. He said, this is too dark. Please send us another one. Okay, next slide shows you, in November, they took another one. And you can see that they did more work too. As they took another one with the hands and no faces again. The next slide. And they make wonderful things, and they are so proud of the fact that now they can help their families be economically independent, because they are even able now to sell some of these clothes in Kamishli. So they are extremely happy about this, and rightly so. The next slide. The next slide, the impact of values. So there's also the value of research. And when we went in 2011, we went to the big storehouse, storeroom, connected with our excavation house, and we took to the village with this man. The man in the red circle was my assistant for many, many years. To work on the ceramics, and he knew everything about the ceramics. The next slide. And he has been working on the ceramics in his house, not independently, but by himself, let's say. And here he is, so happy. Somebody found this little vase on the site. The next slide. He sends us his files. These are the files that he makes, and somebody there types them into an Excel spreadsheet. And the next slide, always remember that this is so close to the Islamic, so-called Islamic State. The next slide. The students in the university asked him, through the university, asked him if he would give them a seminar on our ceramics. So in Kamishli, September 2016, he gave this seminar. And you can see him there. He brought the ceramics to show the students. It was obviously a very good course. The next slide. And these are the students who graduated. So the assistant is there. And also one of the graduates. Look at this graduate up there. The next slide. This is her certificate. They all got a certificate when they completed the course. The next slide, and there she is. She had come with her father to the site. And so this education of young people is really working, certainly in our area. So we're very proud of her. The next slide. And students come to, with